Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to our discussion regarding the 2008 elections and the future of American politics. We are so pleased to have Tom Mann from the Brookings Institution and Norm Ornstein of the American Enterprise Institute for Public Policy Research with us here today, two of my oldest friends from Washington. We actually played tennis every Saturday and every Sunday for 8 years together. And we all won, I think. Both are noted congressional scholars. Tom Mann writes and speaks widely on issues related to campaigns and elections, the effectiveness of Congress. He's conducted polls for congressional candidates and overseen national public opinion studies. He's recently co-authored The Broken Branch, How Congress is Failing America and How to Get It Back on Track. Norm Ornstein is a resident scholar at AEI. He also serves as an election analyst for CBS News and writes a weekly column called Congress Inside Out for Roll Call Newspaper. He serves as senior counselor to the Continuity of Government Commission, working to ensure that institutions of government can be maintained in the event of a terrorist attack on Washington, and of course is co-author of The Broken Branch. I'd like to take a moment to thank Senator Bob Graham and the Bob Graham Center for Public Service for sponsoring this event. Our moderator today, at least for 40 minutes, is Senator Graham. He's the former two-term governor of Florida and, of course, United States Senator, one of the most able public servants in the history of this country. He served for 18 years as senator for a total of 38 years in public service. Since retiring from public life, he's not really retired, he served as chair of the Board of Overseers of the Graham Center for Public Service. The center has a home at the University of Florida and the University of Miami and offers programs in the area of public service, homeland security, and the Americas, subjects of which he has been deeply involved during his public career. In addition, he was recently appointed by Congress to serve as chairman for the Commission on the Prevention of Weapons of Mass Destruction, Proliferation, and Terrorism. The Commission will assess the nation's current activities, initiatives, and develop recommendations for the next administration on how to prevent nuclear and other weapons of mass destruction from falling into the hands of rogue states or terrorists. Please welcome one of the great public servants in this country, more importantly, our own Senator Bob Graham.
Thank you, Madam President. I would like to ask if Norm and Tom would please come forward. Thank you very much for coming this afternoon to talk about a subject which is not only extremely topical. How many people here have already voted? Oh, excellent. Great. And how many people who haven't already voted are going to cross their heart and hope to die that they will vote? Great. Right. Good. Thank you. In addition to talking about this exciting presidential campaign, we also are going to talk some about what the future lies beyond November the 4th. Madam President gave me the beginnings of an excuse. Let me apologize that at about 4:40, I am going to have to leave. Senator Obama has asked me to introduce he and his wife at the event that's going to take place at 5:45 at Bicentennial Park. And when the man that I hope will be the next president of the United States, excuse the partisan comment, asks you to do something, you generally try to accept, and I appreciate the accommodations to allow me to do so. President Shalala has already introduced our two guests, so I'm not going to take more time to repeat or add to the long resumes of accomplishment of these two men, but I'm going to ask a few questions until about 4:40, at which point it'll be your time to ask the questions, and President Shalala will serve as the moderator during that period. Let's start with the most obvious question. We're 2 weeks out from a presidential election. What's your assessment of the campaign that's been run so far? What have we learned about these two candidates during the course of the campaign? And what's going to happen on the evening of November the 4th? Norm, you want to start?
Sure. Well, first of all, the terrain this election year, for the entire year, has been tilted very steeply against any Republican running for president. Americans have not been happy. Pollsters ask a question and have for about 30 years to track the public mood. Do you think America's moving in the right direction or seriously off on the wrong track? We were up at 85% wrong track before the financial meltdown. And even if Democrats control both houses of Congress, the public basically has blamed Republicans for the plight that we are in. So it's been a tough slog for any Republican. The desire for change is what brought us these two candidates, who are not the choices of their party establishments. But, you know, it was fairly clear from the beginning that something dramatic would have to happen for John McCain to be in a position where he could win this election, and that it was going to be basically Obama's to lose. And now it looks like he's going to win, and it wouldn't be surprising if it were a handy victory. I mean, human behavior, you never want to project even 13 days out. Things can happen, but barring some dramatic event, that's where we are. Just quickly, the most interesting thing that I have learned, I believe that campaigns really are a metaphor for whether somebody can govern. How do you pull a campaign together? What do you do with the first executive decision you make, which is the choice of a running mate? Those tell you about whether somebody's got the capability, the executive talent, to be a president. You can win a nomination and win an election without some of those talents. You may be able to win in spite of a campaign. But what I find really striking here is that we had no reason to believe it going in, but Barack Obama has proven to be a superior executive. He pulled together a campaign from scratch, never having done this before, using mostly second-level talent, because the top experienced talent had been sucked up by the Clinton campaign and others, built it across 50 states, the most sophisticated fundraising operation in the history of politics, and set a strategic objective and then worked through all of the bumps along the road to get there without losing his cool. And John McCain, who's an extraordinarily talented man and has been an incredible public servant and senator, has shown that he has no executive ability at all. And as you know, you can succeed in the Senate as you can succeed as a small state governor by virtue of your own skills, but that doesn't mean you can run anything. And I think what we've seen is he can't run much of anything. And the way in which he made the choice of a vice presidential nominee, frankly, was a measure of a decision-making style that has hurt him.
Tom.
Norman's absolutely wrong. McCain is going to win the election in a landslide, and the Republicans are going to recover their majority in the House and the Senate. Not. I don't mean that. I just wanted to make sure that we had some differences up here on the podium. Like Norman, I believe, and in my case have believed for many, many months, and wrote to that effect, that the very likely outcome of this election was a very comfortable Obama victory, 6-point maybe popular vote victory, 350 electoral votes. I felt that way in June and July and September, and I feel that way now. It could actually go higher, so I see that more as a floor, and I think Democrats will gain 7 to 10 seats in the Senate and 20 to 30 seats in the House. It is, in other words, another wave election following the one we had in 2006 in the midterm elections. It's very unusual to have two elections with strong national forces operating in the same direction. It has happened on occasion, but not very often, and it seems almost certain it will happen again, absent some cataclysmic event. Now, people look back at this election year as a fascinating one of great volatility, of uncertainty, of ups and downs, but if you think about it, that applied to the primary season, to the nomination, because we had this extraordinary contest between Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama, both formidable candidates who fought it out over an extended period of time with with some real uncertainty for a long period as to who was going to win. And on the Republican side, we saw the rise, the death, and the rebirth of John McCain to snag the Republican nomination, partly by serendipity, partly by his own resourcefulness, demonstrating you don't have to raise the most money and spend the most money in order to win the election. So there were surprises there, but not so much in the general election, because we have observed historically that when a president is leaving office after two terms and conditions are bad, he's politically unpopular, the economy in turmoil, a costly war, a country desperate for change, we don't have any experience of returning that party to the Oval Office. Americans may not spend a lot of time paying attention to public affairs, but they have a pretty clear and simple notion of democratic accountability. If things have gone bad, you throw out the party of the White House. That's how it works. That's how it's worked every comparable election except one, 1876, and we're going to have a history quiz in a little bit to see how many of you know.
John McCain ran then, too.
Actually, as I recall, Rutherford B. Hayes stood in for McCain in that election. He was the Republican following a two-term Republican presidency, Ulysses S. Grant, who won the election but lost the popular vote and only won the election as a result of a congressional commission, otherwise known as a cabal, in which the Democrats gave the Republicans the presidency as long as federal troops were withdrawn from the Reconstruction South. Not exactly the analogy that we see in place today. So with those powerful forces operating this year, it was always a very uphill race for John McCain, and criticisms of his campaign are partly fair but partly unfair. Anyone playing that weak a hand was bound to run a lousy campaign, at least as evidenced by the results in the poll itself. The only chance John McCain had was to draw such a contrast between himself and the Democratic nominee, of himself, McCain, a hero, a man with an extraordinary biography, a man of character, integrity, decency, straight talk, ready to serve from day one, contrasted with, he hoped, a perception of a candidate new on the national scene without the experience or judgment or knowledge or weight to lead us in these treacherous times. Alas, it didn't work out that way. Through the course of the campaign, we learned many things, as Norm said, but one of the things we learned is that Obama has the temperament for this office, the calm, the cool, the deliberative quality that in the end has seen him, as Americans view him, as the candidate who seems to be less risky, the safest of the candidates, while John McCain, feeling he had to go for some very dramatic moves to try to overcome these structural disadvantages, ends up looking more impulsive and reckless. You put those two things together, it's hard to see how any outcome other than a comfortable Democratic victory awaits us next month.
I just add a little bit to that piece of 1876 history. The deal that Tom just described was cut in Gainesville, Florida. So every time there's a close election, you know where to look for the ultimate resolution. Let me use the few minutes that I have left with you to move to the second part of our program, which is the future of American politics. Nationally, and particularly here in Florida, where we suffered the consequences of Democratic candidates not being allowed to come to campaign during the primary season, a long period when it looked like we might not even have any delegates at the convention. we've been particularly incensed at the process that we have used. What do you think is going to come out of 2008 in terms of reform for the 2012 selection of the president?
Well, Bob, you know, the Republicans have a rule that says any changes in the delegate selection process have to be approved by the prior convention. That is, any changes to be in effect for 2012 would have had to have been adopted in St. Paul, Minnesota, at the Republican National Party Convention. The Rules Committee of the party had put forward a plan to really alter the schedule of events, to really try to bring some order to this process. But in the end, the presidential nominee always has the last word, and John McCain decided not to go for that ambitious plan. So they approved some pretty minor changes that basically puts in place the system as it now exists and tells Florida and Michigan to back off and don't engage in such silly efforts to reschedule the primaries again. For their part, the Democrats have appointed a commission. That commission has the power to recommend a new system and to get it approved by the Democratic National Committee. If so, it would be in place for 2012. But the likelihood is that nothing of major consequence will happen. Why? Because Barack Obama survived this system. He won a battle with the most formidable imaginable candidate, Hillary Clinton. It was long. It was an extended process in which more Democrats and independents got to participate in the selection of their nominee than any others had before. And in the end, if he's successful, Democrats will judge, hey, whatever the shortcomings of this system, it produced a successful nominee. We had high rates of participation. If it ain't broke, don't fix it.
A student had asked, and maybe Norm, you could comment on this, whether there was any chance that the Electoral College might be altered in the foreseeable future.
I think probably not. If we were to have another election like 2000, where a candidate won the popular vote but lost the Electoral College, the second time in our lifetimes we would see a backlash. It was really interesting that we didn't see it at all in 2000. The public reaction was not outrage, but basically a sense that, well, these are the rules, and it's like a tennis match. You can win the most games, but you lose by sets. So we didn't have that, but we would have it again. If it happens. It's not likely to happen this time, of course. Now, what is occurring is we are seeing, bubbling up in a few states, the notion of making unilateral changes. As you know, we have the allocation of electoral votes within states is made by the states. And we have two states, Maine and Nebraska, that have decided to allocate their electoral votes, which is effectively the number of representatives you have plus your two senators. And for Maine with four electoral votes, and Nebraska with, is it six, I think, or seven, they do it by congressional district. So in Maine, two go to the statewide winner for the senators, and then you could win one if you pick off a congressional district. The McCain campaign, with very few places to turn among the blue states, is actually campaigning in half of Maine to try and win that one electoral vote. And the Obama campaign has been putting some resources into Omaha to win that one. There's been some movement in a state like California to shift that state to a proportional representation in effect. The problem is that in a state like California, if you did that, it would basically be a tremendous body blow to one party, the Democrats, who otherwise win the state and win the entire body of votes. So that only works if it happens spontaneously in all states. And in the absence of that, there'll be discussion, but no change.
This week, Senator Obama reported that in September, his campaign had raised $150 million dollars, shattering all previous fundraising standards. Do you think there will be any significant changes as a result of this campaign in the way in which we finance our campaign? Is the idea of public financing of presidential campaigns dead?
It's an excellent question, and I think a very important one for us. Remember, there are two parts to the public financing system. The first applying to the nomination season. There we have matching grants tied to state-level spending limits. George W. Bush, the candidate, opted out of that system in 2000 and went on to win the nomination and the presidency, the first time that had happened. In 2004, Howard Dean and John Kerry decided they could raise more money without the public funds and spend it, and to be competitive with George Bush, then the incumbent president, they needed to opt out. And this time around, to accept public funding in the primary season was an indication of being a marginal candidate. So if you were a player, you had to opt out. But as you point out, this is the first time that we've had a general election candidate decline the second feature of the public funding system, namely a public grant. This year it was worth $84 million. The theory behind it when first passed in 1974 is that would be the total general election budget. But over time, that has eroded with interpretations of the Supreme Court that said political parties can raise and spend as much money as possible on behalf of their candidate as long as they do it independently, so that John McCain can spend his $84 million and the Republican National Committee could try to raise and spend another $200 or $300 or $400 million. Obama could have accepted the public funding and then helped the DNC raise the money. But Obama decided that having strategic control of all the resources to decide what states were going to get the money for ads and organization, when and in what manner, was very important to him. So he opted out, and can you believe the amount of money? I mean, it's just breathtaking. The first full month of fundraising, $150 million, 600,000 new donors. He's up to over 3 million. It's a combination of small contributions over the internet plus those who can pay up to a maximum of $2,300 for the general election. Bob, my view is that the public funding system is now broke. The first part fell out of use because it was no longer a useful incentive for candidates to participate. The spending limits were too low, the public funding inadequate, and that fell by the wayside, and now the other system is beginning to fall by the wayside because of the rise of small donors. I think we still need some kind of floor, but probably have to remove the spending limits from it. If we had had Clinton and Obama accept public funding in the nomination season, we couldn't have had that extraordinary contest. They would have been out of money by New Hampshire. You need more money to actually engage in a serious competitive campaign, and I think we're going to have to go back to the drawing boards and see if there isn't a way to provide some support to keep more candidates in the game early, long enough for citizens to have a choice, but ultimately to try to ride this wave of small donors to finance our campaigns in the future.
Just a quick comment. We're in a completely different world now. Barack Obama has raised more money than all of the candidates combined in both parties in 2000, which was another open contest. But he's been able to do it by using this new tool of the internet. He wasn't the first, but he's moved it to a completely different level. And now you've got people who are used to using credit cards to give money when they buy things, now doing it with campaigns. Unlike the previous method of trying to raise money from small donors, direct mail, or doing retail campaigning. I knew a lot of candidates who used to do barbecues at $25 a head, until it reached a point where it cost far more to do the barbecue than any of the money that they could pull in. Now you actually have opportunities to raise money from larger groups of small donors. And I think we have to change the way we think about public financing or financing of campaigns to take that into account. So if we could return to a tax credit for small contributions, 100% tax credit for contributions of, say, $100 or less, maybe have an income cap to keep the drain in the treasury from being too great, but also to keep it from being just free money for wealthy people. And then combine that with a more generous matching fund, 2-to-1 or 3-to-1. Once you get over a threshold to show that you've got some breadth of support, we could have a new world of campaign financing where big donors become simply less relevant. And it'll be really interesting to see if Obama wins this presidency with this base of donors, if the trial lawyers come to him and say, you know, if you support this legislation, we're going to cut off the funding, or the hedge fund operators, then he can say, I've got other sources of funding. It may reduce, it won't remove, but it may reduce some of those links that we've had that both parties have between the big interests and the people in office who are held hostage on narrow issues, and it may change the whole way we think about things.
We are either going to elect the first African-American president or the first female vice president in America's history. If Barack Obama is elected, how do you think his African-American, very complex history will affect Americans' attitude towards America and the world's attitude towards America?
Well, let me say first, you know, both of these are historic. And when Sarah Palin was picked, my reaction was that she was the prettiest vice presidential nominee since John Edwards. But with that out of the way.
Did you write that?
Yes. Obama is going to have a transformative effect, certainly around the world. I've traveled fairly extensively in Asia and in Europe, and it is amazing. You know, most people, if there were electoral votes in Asia and in Europe, this election would have been over a long time ago. But there's been a disbelief that America could actually do this, a feeling that, you know, it's not real, it won't happen. And there will be a quite remarkable effect, as there will be in some ways here at home. Looking abroad, I think it has a potential to transform our relationships with the rest of the world. But keep in mind that Barack Obama as a president is going to act in America's national interest. And frankly, for the last 8 years, a lot of other countries have used George Bush as much as an excuse as anything else. The Europeans have said, well, we don't have to do anything on global warming, and we're not going to do anything to help in the Middle East because, you know, they dissed us, and they're trying to behave as bullies and do it unilaterally. Just watch what happens when President Obama says to Europe, now we're going to be a partnership. Let's talk about more troops for Afghanistan. And all of a sudden, it's going to be, well, we don't have the money, we really can't afford it, we've got our own problems. And elsewhere in the world, the sense that you've got an African-American, it's going to change the rhetoric of Ahmadinejad, of Chavez, of Putin. It's going to be much harder to refer to us as the great Satan. You're going to have a sense of renewal, an opportunity to transform things. But America's national interest is not always in consonance with the interests of other countries, either our adversaries or others. So we're still going to have some difficulties and rough patches. Here at home, I think the greatest opportunity for change may come within the African-American community. I think there's a disbelief among a lot of Americans that this could happen. And when it does happen, his ability to communicate with all audiences, but including his own community, it's going to be very interesting to watch. It's something that has gotten Jesse Jackson very upset because his message is not Jackson's message, and it's going to be received in a different way. I don't think one person can transform culture, but I think you can make an enormous difference. And if you have now somebody who crosses this threshold, the change that it makes in a bunch of different communities, the reality of saying you can be anything, has got to have some impact on the world. And if he is a successful president, and he has every talent to do so, it's got to affect not only our politics, but our culture in a lot of ways down the road.
Bob, if I could just add a couple of footnotes. One, I think we'll look back on this year is that it was Hillary Clinton more than Sarah Palin who really had an impact on the role of women in seeking the presidency and higher office. And I suspect we will not be many years away from a female president. Among the many fascinating things about Obama's candidacy is the extent to which he ran it as a post-racial campaign, not as one anchored in the substance and politics of race or ethnicity at all. The whole theme was to bring us together. We are not a red America or blue America, we are the United States of America. And that came in the 2004 keynote, but it's been the common theme of his candidacy. And one of the reasons that he has been doing so well and appears to be on the verge of victory is that he is able to capitalize on an extraordinary base of African American voters without directly appealing to them, instead appealing to the broad American landscape of communities and citizens and the like. After Iowa, African Americans suddenly said, oh my God, we could actually elect a black president. And they abandoned Hillary. They were strong supporters of Hillary and moved into his camp. Now it's likely that 97-98% of blacks will vote for Obama, and the turnout will probably increase by 10 percentage points or more. But that is happening without the sort of direct appeals that might then have led to some more reaction and much more racially polarized voting. As best as we can tell, there is some racial resentment vote that will cost Obama something. But the net effect is likely to be very small, and that's partly because of the kind of campaign he ran. And Bob, I think it opens up the possibility, if Obama is elected and can govern successfully in the face of these extraordinary challenges, he, unlike many other presidents, has a chance to, obviously, to fail, but also to rise to greatness and do so not as a black president, but as the president who happens to be African American, which in my mind gives him then the flexibility and others that follow to also begin to direct and design policies that might lift up those within his community that have been left behind.
I apologize that this is going to be my last question. You may be happy about that because now it's going to be your questions. No question, there's been an enormous amount of energy generated by this campaign. I have been involved with a group called the Conference for Citizenship, which has just published a booklet on the Civic Health Index, a national report and a Florida report. One of the questions it's asking here is, after the campaign is over, after all the banners are down and the big crowds have dispersed, will there be, following this energy, a new level of civic involvement by Americans? Will there be more participation in community service? Will there be a greater sense of volunteerism? All the ways in which we express our citizenship in a democracy. What's your level of optimism that this is going to be a transformational election in terms of civic participation after the election?
Well, I've been so down on American public life for so long that as a natural optimist about our political system and our constitutional system, I prefer to take the positive view of these developments, that it has been so striking to me to see the level of engagement, interest, participation of the youngest cohort, 18 to 29 years old, they have gotten engaged in a way that this will now be the third election in which their rates of voting participation will increase more rapidly than the rest of the population. Mind you, they begin it as the lowest participating. That's true of every democracy in the world. Young people are less anchored in family and community, but it really is changing. They are engaging. The new technologies of the internet and cell phones, forms of social networking have really created a level of engagement and a richness to that that goes well beyond simply voting. There are other forms of participation. My guess is that Obama's not going to throw away his list of email list of 3 million contributors to him. That's a bold prediction, isn't it? That he's not going to throw that away. He has millions of other people on his list. He is going to be working with that list in a governing sense and trying to engage in online conversations of mobilizing support. On the other hand, there's a lot of folks out there, mainly young people, who don't want to be talked to. They don't see this as top down. They see it as bottom up. And they're going to be looking for ways of communicating and aggregating opinions and judgments and conveying those to office holders. So I'm anticipating a really significant change in the dynamics of citizen engagement in our politics over time.
Just before you leave, Bob, I think my greatest disappointment with President Bush was after 9/11 that he did not issue a call for national service and instead said we should sacrifice by shopping. And I think we lost an incredible opportunity when the country was ready to come together. And we may have another opportunity here. And it may be driven not just by a transformative election, but by the problems we face at home, the financial ones that are going to lead to other social strains. It is a perfect opportunity to issue another call for national service. And I think we now have a large group of people who would be eager to take up that challenge.
Tom, Norm, thank you very much. I appreciate the opportunity to have shared the podium. Thank you for your participation. And now, President.
Thanks, Bob.
Thank you very much. We want to thank Mrs. Graham, too, for joining us. Let's get some questions from the audience. Who has a question? Dean Verkile.
Public life. Do you think it's more important now to national service? Maybe it's more important now to spend money. And one of the problems with the economy is, after all, the fact that we're spending money to shut down. I always say that, Norm, as a kind of lead into to your question. And I do think, how do you see the need for public service?
Well, I guess I'd make a couple of points. First, there's a lot of truth to that. I give President Bush some credit in being able to get quality people like Bob Gates and Michael Mukasey and Hank Paulson to come in at the tail end of a second term of a lame duck president. Even Mukasey, with whom I have, it was at least a very significant improvement on his predecessor. That you could get people at that level to come in, at least it meant something. But we've got a problem. It's a problem that will be helped by having a president who ignites excitement. And I think you're going to find a huge number of people who never would have thought about public service before Of course, many of them because they're now unemployed, perhaps, going in. But we need to do an awful lot to streamline a process of such absurdity that Donna Shalala had to spend a fortune to get her forms filled out, as everybody at that level did, because of the crazy hurdles we put up. Some people are willing to go through it, but others aren't. And we need to streamline that process, and I hope it's something that where we'll get some help with Bush going out and with a new president coming in. In terms of national service, in some ways you are spending money. If you put people off in productive work in their communities, national service doesn't just mean going into the military, although God knows we need to rebuild our military at this point. It also means work in communities, and that can mean working on infrastructure, it can mean working on healthcare, it can mean working in a whole host of ways that where people give something back, but you're also getting something out into the society.
Good.
Our politics and policymaking have suffered from ideological rigidity and the intensely polarized feelings of those who come into office. It really showed up in some very destructive ways in the Department of Justice, but also showed up in ways where appointments were made of people utterly unqualified to assume the responsibilities. And we've somehow got to get beyond this point. There are examples in recent history and administrations in which very able people were recruited to office. Donna, her 8 years at HHS is a perfect example of how you can recruit extremely able people, engage the careerist, and provide leadership to accomplish some things. And we have to get back to that and spread it to other departments. We have to demand of our new president just superb appointments of people who have high integrity and competence to serve. And then we're going to have to think about restructuring the public service and making it easier for people to move in and out of government, because so many young people nowadays also want experience in nonprofits and private sectors. There are many things we could do to really revitalize public life in America.
With the likelihood that we have a Democratic president, Democratic Congress, Democratic Senate, maybe even a filibuster-proof Senate, has that historically been healthy, and do you think it will be in this instance?
Well, first, I'm skeptical that there is any such thing as a filibuster-proof Senate. And everybody, you're going to see, probably on election eve, if the presidential race is over relatively early, and we know it's over, and we may know it with Florida, then they're going to turn to what happens next. And what you're going to see is, because the networks are looking for a horse race, the horse race is going to be, will they get to that magic 60? But, getting to 60, let me just give you two words. Joe Lieberman. And I could add Ben Nelson and 10 others. Some on the right, and then a couple, like Bernie Sanders on the left, who are going to have great difficulty coming to an agreement about anything, especially if it were to mean sweeping legislation going through on one-party basis alone. It's not going to happen. The Democrats, as they pick up seats in the House and Senate, are going to pick up a lot of moderates. In the House, it's going to be predominantly blue dog Democrats. And you're going to have maybe 50 of them who are already flexing their muscles, even as you'll have 50 on the left saying nothing happens without us. So, frankly, nothing much of significance or sweep will happen without a bipartisan agreement. And for Barack Obama, I think the biggest challenge is going to come from his own left, which is going to have very high expectations. But because most of the Republicans who are leaving and most of those who will lose are the remaining moderates, will be down to a trace element of moderate Republicans, reaching out to Republicans is going to mean reaching out to conservatives. And so it's going to take some tricky elements here. But there will not be one-party rule now. And it's going to require coalition building. The good news in some ways for Obama, I believe, is the financial meltdown gives him an opportunity to move in incremental ways and not fulfill any of those expectations of grandiose plans. He's got a very good excuse for doing so. And that's the best way to operate now, especially if he can move quickly, get a few things done to raise the appetite of people and create the expectation that you can build those alliances. Then you can make something happen. And this is an instance I would have said 4 or 5 years ago, or 10 years ago, divided government in this polarized system paradoxically gives us the best chance to make things work. I'm not sure that's the case anymore.
I think just, again, a footnote to this. Divided government in the past has been quite productive. In this environment, it is not, and more likely to be a repeat of the last 2 years. I do not expect Obama to lead an intensely partisan government or to have a strategy that's based fully on taking advantage of the enlarged Democratic majorities. And I actually think those larger majorities will give Pelosi and Reid the breathing room to actually engage Republicans. Not the center of gravity of the Republican Party, but I bet you there's 10 or 15 Republican senators in the Senate and 30 or 40 in the House that would like to engage in serious deliberation and lawmaking, and I think they will, from the very beginning, try to build that in.
Joseph Salch, Junior here. First of all,
Joseph,
I love the socks.
Oh, thank you.
Second of all, you guys are experts, obviously, on congressional elections. Can we talk a little bit about what shifts do you think are going to happen in the Congress this election year? Because for the first time since I can remember, we're having very well-financed Democrats opposing longtime incumbents for Congress, such as the Diaz-Balart brothers and Ileana Ross-Layton. And we have, Ro Martinez and Netadeo and Joe Garcia, whose wife is probably here because she's our general counsel. But do you think it's going to be a big shift in the Congress this year? Or, I mean, what do you think is going to happen? Can you just tie on that a little bit?
I do. Democrats have several advantages. One is the retirements. Five Republican senators decided to retire, no Democrats. And similarly, in the House now, there are 30 open Republican-held seats and only 8 Democratic-held seats. So there are opportunities in the open seats. But in addition to that, Democrats have been successful in registering many more of their voters, in raising money both at the candidate level and at the national party level, and in recruiting exceptionally able candidates to contest Republican incumbents. And a good case in point is to be found right here in South Florida. Then you put that together with what appears to be a sort of another wave election, as we had in 2006, where some fraction of the electorate is sort of switching from the disadvantaged party, in this case the Republicans, to the other. That's a potent mix for a substantial change in both the House and the Senate. This is happening in spite of the fact that most congressional seats are absolutely safe and not contested at all. But there are enough to make a huge difference. So I'm guessing that that Florida will see some turnover in its delegation. And they've gone back-to-back elections without having any. This has been one of the least competitive states in terms of the House elections, to say nothing of the state legislative elections. I look for some Republican House incumbent defeats in Florida, and if the overall margin of Obama is above 6%, you should not be shocked to see Democrats pick up another 30 seats on top of the 30 they picked up in 2006.
Of course, Florida's at the cutting edge in other ways. There may be two Democratic incumbents across the country who are endangered. One of them right here in Tom's home of West Palm Beach, which seems to be the scandal capital of the world. I don't know what's going on. It actually reminds, we had Vito Fisella, Vito Fisella of Staten Island was just had his trial last week for drunk driving in suburban Virginia. He's another casualty in this election. He was picked up. It turned out he was on his way to his mistress's to visit his love child, which came as news to his wife. And he announced he was retiring, and my response was he wants to spend more time with his families. So you may have a little bit of that down here in Palm Beach, too.
Much of the rhetoric of Obama's campaign has gone against interest groups and at times big business. And I remember you wrote in the Washington Post, I think referencing Moynihan, that you can't really bring change to Washington without the help of special interest groups and big business. So do you feel that Obama needs to worry about alienating himself from those Washington insiders? Or do you think, like with campaign financing, he's going to be able to transcend that need to engage them?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I was really referring even more just simply to a disdain for insiders that was typified by Sarah Palin and her choice. And, you know, I had a lot of people telling me, well, this is great. She's just like me. And I said, you know, I just flew across the Atlantic, and I didn't demand a pilot who was just like me. And when I'm having surgery, I don't want a surgeon who's just like me. You want some level of expertise. But in fact, it's a problem for Obama, whose rhetoric on lobbyists has gone over the top. And it, you know, it works out there. People hate lobbyists. But Obama's going to have a hell of a time finding some of the best people to make things happen in a very complicated place, in a system constitutionally designed to make it difficult to make things happen without having some insiders. He's smart enough to know that. I hope he doesn't go further in this front. One of the big mistakes that Bill Clinton made in trying to respond to the tenor of the times was to pledge that he would cut the White House staff by 25%. And it led to some of the disasters that occurred in his White House. So I don't want to preclude some smart, dedicated people who happen to be lobbyists. Some of them happen to be lobbyists for poor people. They're not just lobbyists for big financial institutions, but even some of them from being able to serve and understanding that we need people who know how to make this process work. And among other things, I'm hoping that Obama will pick Tom Daschle, the former majority leader and a real insider, as chief of staff, who's got all the talents to do that, and who might have been a running mate if it weren't for the fact that his wife is a lobbyist. But I don't think it will preclude him from serving honorably in the public, and there are lots of others out there.
Sergio.
How do you see the Democrat, the Hispanic vote going this election, one, if indeed you see it going more Democratic or Obama? Is that a recovery that has by the Democratic Party that's sustainable? Or are we to expect a less homogeneous Hispanic vote in future elections from a partisan perspective?
I believe every bit of evidence suggests that the overall Hispanic vote will be of the order of 2-1 Democratic, that it will be a much higher performance for Democrats than enjoyed in 2004 and 2000, really back closer to what Bill Clinton did in the 1990s. Now, part of that is simply the nature of the times. The overall vote will be higher for Democrats. But in addition to that, I think the politics of immigration, which had a clear effect over a decade ago in California, turning that state into a very safe Democratic state in presidential politics, it has happened to some extent in national politics as well. And so I think the combination of those factors will produce a strong Hispanic vote for Obama and for the Democratic Party. Now, whether that's sustained over time remains to be seen. If you look at the preferences, the policy preferences and orientations of Hispanic groups of all sorts, by the way, including Cuban Americans, you will find on a range of domestic policy issues, the center of gravity in those communities is for a more active government, one more, a position more comfortable with in the Democratic than in the Republican Party. But obviously there are other issues, including some social issues that cut the other way. But my sense is, bottom line is that the hope that George Bush and Karl Rove had to build on the governor's Texas experience to help build an enduring national Republican majority anchored in part in strong Hispanic support has come and gone, and Democrats are now in the catbird seat to solidify that vote.
Let me just take a slight, I won't take issue with it so much as the immigration issue is going to be even more difficult to resolve in the next 4 years, I think. I mean, it's interesting, we just had a story that illegal immigration coming across the Mexican border has dropped to almost nothing because of our economic situation. So I joke that George Bush said, see, I was able to solve one problem. But let's face it, if unemployment here goes to 8% or 9%, that palpable sense that has been largely, I think, inaccurate, that these illegal people are coming in and taking our jobs because they basically fulfilled a demand that hasn't been filled by others, that will become a reality for a lot of people. And the backlash against doing something about the 12 million undocumented workers and families who are here is going to be even greater. And so the ability, if you can't resolve that, and if many in your own party decide to go with a strongly anti-immigrant sentiment, and some Democrats will, it'll get trickier to solidify those generations into a more enduring majority. And that will be a big challenge for Obama. You're not going to resolve that in the first year. But he's got to find a way to come up with a solution that has eluded us so far.
We've got a question here. And then I'll...
Thank you. My name is Duane Schultz. I'm a professor at the medical school. My question is, I've been upset with the lethargy of our Senate and House of Representatives for what I fear are, or what I think are many critical issues. And I've also been upset with both parties during the political debates over what I call stretching the truth and half-truth. And so my question is, do you think there would be any merit in a third major political party?
We certainly have found throughout our history that third parties and prominent independent candidates have served a very constructive purpose, where major problems were unaddressed, where there was a void in the political spectrum. They have moved in, gotten attention, and ultimately got absorbed by one or the other party, which felt obliged to deal with the problems. You could argue that Ross Perot's candidacy in 1992 helped move Bill Clinton to pay early attention to the deficit, which he did in a very responsible fashion. I actually see more hope in a system of democratic accountability with the two major parties, where if one hasn't produced, you throw them out and give the other an opportunity to govern, and if they don't, you replace them. Then I do in turning to a outside third party.
Turn your energies not to a third party, but to redistricting reform. Because the big problem we've got, I'm afraid, is that our parties have moved to the ends and have left a vacuum in the middle. Now, I think Obama's going to try and fill that vacuum in the middle. But, you know, for all the talk that we've engaged in about these congressional elections, if 15 incumbent members of the House are defeated, it will be pretty stunning this time around. If it went to 25, it would be even more stunning. Most of the turnover is still going to come in open seats. And what we're going to be left with, the core group of Republicans who are left withstood a tsunami, two in a row, actually. And the idea that they're going to be responsive to a larger public demand when they're in districts that are homogeneous and basically echo chambers and pull them over in one direction, dominated by a small core of ideological activists, not easy to find. And for many of the Democrats who are there, you've got the same phenomenon, but over on the other side. So I just want to see a healthier middle in our politics, and we've begun to lose that. If we get that back, and you have a significant number in both parties who are operating between the 40-yard lines or the 30-yard lines even, instead of back around the goalposts, then we'd have healthier politics. We'd still have stiff competition, but you'd have easier opportunities to build the coalitions where most voters are and where the policies need to be near the middle.
I've got three questions. One, two, three. Fred Frohawk back there, the chair of political science. He's a political therapist,
yeah.
So you don't have to worry about this.
Religious discourse seems to be a more vital part of campaign rhetoric than has been the case in the past, at least explicitly so. And I'm not referring to the campaign rhetoric, the religious rhetoric of George Bush, but the expectation that candidates will demonstrate an affinity for religion, experience with religion, and affiliation with the church. Do you think these expectations will be contracted if a Democratic administration comes into power, or are we heading in one way or another toward a rethinking, an innovative rethinking of the traditional wall between church and state with different institutional arrangements and expectations of practices?
Such an interesting and an important question. You know, perhaps the greatest bias in America doesn't exist against racial minorities or women or various ethnic immigrant groups. It occurs among those who are secular, agnostic or atheist. Can you imagine a candidate nowadays running for the highest office who is secular? And it's hard to imagine. Now, America has always seen religion as a mainspring of community life and public life, but have, for the most part, managed to maintain separate spheres, but religion has animated most of the political movements in America historically, on the left as well as on the right, and I don't see any sign that this is going away. The changes I see on religion and politics this year is more a diversification within the religious community of a belief that the agenda of religious people should go beyond one or two litmus test issues, that there is greater diversity in the community about the importance of poverty, of public health around the world, of global warming, and not just a sort of set of social issues. I think some people are frustrated by the extent to which sort of religious people who practice their faith and their religion on a sort of regular, daily, weekly basis have aligned themselves with a broader political ideology that doesn't in any way derive from their religious faith and commitment. So that's where we're trying to sort things out. And I frankly see a lot of very positive developments, more pluralism within our religious community, more tolerance and openness to sort of people of faith among Democrats, which I think is a healthy thing, but one would hope that would extend eventually to tolerance of non-religious people as well. But it's a period of ferment, and for the most part, I think a positive one.
Now, two more questions. One here.
My name is Jackie Rose. I want to thank you both for coming. It's been a wonderful program. I'd like your thoughts about two things. One of the biggest problems we're having now is unemployment and people getting out of school and jobs not really being there. Wouldn't this be a good time for a domestic Peace Corps and WPA projects like Roosevelt had to get people employed and help that situation? And then what's your feeling about how this is going to affect the Supreme Court?
Well, in the first instance, I think that's really where a national service program comes in. You would use an awful lot of people going into national service in WPA-type projects. And I suspect, you know, in some ways, the perfect opportunity to do this is early in an administration when we're going to get, I'm sure, yet another infrastructure plan. And, of course, we'll try and define infrastructure as broadly as we possibly can. Everything will be infrastructure because that's popular and it's significant right now, and even Ben Bernanke is endorsing it. And, you know, tying it to getting young people out in their communities and doing some of these things is a good way to do it. On the Supreme Court, this has been one of the sharpest differences in the end between the candidates, but one that doesn't tend to motivate many voters because it's a second-order thing. Just as a vice presidential nomination doesn't really affect all that many votes, almost no matter what, because you're looking a little further down the line. But we know that there is a very substantial likelihood that there'll be one, two, or three vacancies on the Supreme Court in the next term. We know that we have a court that is sharply divided, basically 5-4 on many critical issues. The fifth vote that was Sandra Day O'Connor's now is Justice Kennedy's. And Sandra Day O'Connor's was a vote that really was very close to the center. And Kennedy is center right. And we know that the single most likely person to leave in the first term will be Justice Stevens, who is in his upper 80s. Now, you know, down here in Miami, that's
a young man, right?
Compared to Edna, that's youth.
My family.
There are some good genes in the on the Shalala side, of all different varieties, not just longevity. And then Justice Ginsburg has had some health issues as well. If you had two conservatives in the mold of Roberts and Alito, or Scalia and Thomas replacing them, you've got a 7-2 court, and one that will be there for a very long time, and one that would show a great willingness to restrict the Commerce Clause, to dramatically transform the role of the institutions and of the federal government in a whole host of ways. And maybe as important as the presidency in terms of its impact on American public life. And an Obama presidency would choose different kinds of people. My guess is, by the way, that he would not choose particularly strong liberals. Although, you know, there are people who I'm sure he would favor who might fit in that category, but there'd be much more likely to be people along the lines of Steve Breyer. And I can imagine one of them possibly being Cass Sunstein, a very good friend of his from the University of Chicago Law School, whose views are eclectic on a whole host of issues. Here you have a president who's not going to rely on his attorney general to give him nominees for the Supreme Court. He knows these people, and he knows the ones, and he knows the issues, having taught constitutional law. So it would be significant, but just keep in mind that if those are the ones who leave, we're still probably back to a 5-4 court. That's still going to have pretty much the center of gravity where it is now. So don't expect great change. It's the great change that would come if McCain were to win more than the other side.
Last question back there. Yep.
Hi. Gregory Koger, also in the Political Science Department. One of the challenges of being president is setting an agenda. And so if Senator Obama wins, he will face a wide array of problems, having made a lot of promises during the campaign. So I wonder what you would recommend as maybe his top three legislative priorities for 2009.
I'll take an initial crack at that. In my view, his immediate focus has to be on the here and now. That means the financial markets and the recession. We are facing perilous times. There's probably another half dozen iterations of government guarantees and moving in to prevent some major financial institution from from going down, of making the transition within Treasury and having a team up that can implement the plans and create new plans for those that don't work. It's going to be a huge priority of managing a program of trying to achieve financial stability, because until we do, our economy is choked. That also means moving toward a new regulatory regime for these institutions. It's very complicated, but he really has a chance to make a major contribution here. And I think there's a possibility of working both sides of the aisle on this, because this isn't a issue that divides parties as dramatically as some others do. Second is the recession itself, that we're in it now almost certainly. The odds are it's going to be a global recession, and it will last longer rather than shorter and be relatively deep. It's going to be tough. It's going to require a number of steps to try to mitigate the economy and the recession and its costs, but there are always risks that what you do have no effect but cost a lot, or you take steps that have pernicious effects in the long term. So again, the priority is doing sensible stimulus programs that don't compromise your ability to deal with the longer term challenges. Now, as part of the stimulus, I could see him moving initially on his energy promises. The question about jobs, a key part of it over the longer haul is creating jobs by making the transition to a green economy. And therefore, early funds that you can get out with projects on the books ready to go, development projects for renewable energy will be an important part of that. So I see that as consistent. Then, so I have two packages. The third is in the healthcare arena. And there I would, and would have before the financial meltdown, set aside the Big Bang idea that we're going to pass the penultimate bill in 100 days or 12 months or 2 years, but instead begin to make some progress on this issue. Regain the trust of the American people. You really do cover all children. You move first with the S-CHIP program. There are votes there already to accomplish it. There are ways you can move ahead with the information technology by making some early investments. There are ways of beginning to grapple with quality, partly by relying on states that are already beginning to experiment using professional groups to make judgments about the efficacy of various kinds of medical interventions, and experiment with setting up reimbursement systems for interventions that actually do some good as a way of beginning to get control on healthcare costs. If I had any say, that's how I would look to begin the first year of an Obama administration.
I'd add a couple of things substantively, but it is really important that the new president first hit the ground running, not on January 20th, but on November the 5th. The typical tendency of a new president is first you're exhausted, and you need some time to rest up and savor your victory. Then you end up having a few sometimes symbolic meetings, or as Clinton did, a big summit on the economy, and then you start planning for your inaugural. And in the meantime, you've got people who are being hired, but you aren't really focusing on how you're going to structure your White House staff, make the first key hires, really move along to make sure you've got your top people, not just the cabinet, but the sub-cabinet in place. And, of course, you've got every member of Congress calling you up and every major donor pushing you to take their friends or their children for jobs, and you're trying to juggle all of those things. And you don't really look at what you're going to do until January comes, and you don't have your people in place, and then you don't really exploit the first 100 days. There's 77 days between November 5th and January 20th that are every bit as important in preparing the groundwork. Then you've got to look at the first 100 days, the second 100 days, what you can accomplish in your first year. If you don't do it early, as Bill Clinton learned, your first 2 years can be utterly miserable. So some of it is an agenda driven by the external events. But you can exploit those external events. In an infrastructure package to get the economy moving, you can not only move in some green jobs, but you can move, say, to revitalize the electrical grid, which is a disaster in the country. It's not just oil. It's electricity is a critical element of it. You can start to do something in science and math to expand the research and development by folding it into infrastructure. You can do some of your energy priorities with research and development and alternative fuels as part of that package. You've got to do something more for the unemployed if we're going to move up to 7, 8, or 9%. There, too, we ought to think about something on the healthcare front. People fall back on a safety net that is a bed of nails called COBRA. And you've got to do something to make that a bit more of a cushion. And I don't know what it is. Maybe it's allowing people who are unemployed to go on Medicare or Medicaid for a while. That might be the best solution, to offer the alternative of keeping your own insurance, for which instead of paying the 20 or 30% that you pay because your employer subsidizes the rest, you got to pay 105% when you're out of work. And we've got to do something, and I would also make this a part of the first 100 days. I would create that homeowners loan corporation, the FDR-era corporation, that there's now authority in the Treasury Department, but really create a structure to begin to renegotiate mortgages and keep people in their homes. Most foreclosures are not because people took utterly irresponsible loans or had a bunch of properties that they were flipping. It's because they've had an illness in the family, or a divorce, or they're thrown out of their jobs, and they can't sell their houses. And if you start to have all those houses go on the market because they're foreclosed upon, then nobody else is going to be able to sell a house, and it creates a freeze in the economy. So it's got to be an early focus as well. Then you can come back with some of the other things. And, of course, you can do SCHIP early on. You can do information technology in healthcare, small pieces. But you can't try and do everything, and you've got to figure out how you can focus and get a few big accomplishments early that build political capital to use in the next stage. And, this is a smart guy who I think is thinking about these things, but it's very hard to act on them until you're actually president.
You both have assumed that it's inevitable that...
That was a question. Yeah. I had a question. Yeah. That's my question.
Why is it inevitable? David.
You talked about regaining trust. There are those of us who still have concern that we could have 1984 replicated around the country. In spite of early voting, it's not too difficult to imagine voting machines malfunctioning or becoming inoperable in certain precincts and having a stolen election. You haven't mentioned that. What makes you think that it's a done deal?
Well, first of all, if we had a close election, God help us. Because the fact is that since 2000, even after the Help America Vote Act and other things that have been done, we still have a broken election system. And there are going to be a lot of places around the country where the election officials have known for 6 months or a year that there was going to be a huge increase in turnout. They are not prepared with printed ballots where they use them, with enough machines, with enough poll workers. So we're going to have big problems there. Early voting, which in general I don't like, because I don't like people voting before you have all the information in. Things happen, and you can't do do-overs. But that's going to ease some of those pressures. But, you know, when you look at everything that's occurring out in the electorate, knowing that the world can change just like that, but putting even the possibility of that happening, the greatest likelihood is that we have a comfortable victory where none of this stuff will take hold. Frankly, I fear a close election for all the reasons that you've suggested, but also now this drumbeat about ACORN, which is, you know, not a model organization, but we do not have widespread fraud at the polls. We never have had. We are not going to. We have some fraudulent activity in registrations, You know, all the Dallas Cowboys were put into register in New Mexico. That doesn't mean that Terrell Owens is going to show up at some polling place in Albuquerque, or somebody claiming to be Terrell Owens will show up. That's somebody making a fast buck by filling out a lot of registration forms. But when you create the sense that we've got the most corrupt process in history and you get a close election, then you've created the seeds for having a third or a half of the country who believe that the outcome is illegitimate. So there's every reason for us to hope, whichever way it goes, that this is a comfortable victory. But everything out there on the table suggests it will be.
There's a report today issued Washington by Pew Charitable Trust, electionline.org, identifying 12 states with potential problems. You'll be shocked to hear the state of Florida is on that list.
Let me let me end with one story. And early in my career as a political scientist, I was a poll watcher in Brooklyn, New York. And I was sitting there, and some guy came up, and he gave me his name. I looked down the list, and it said deceased. And I looked up at him, and I said, "You're dead." And he said, "You're right." And he turned around and left. At any rate, let me ask Norm and Tom for some final comments. I do remember that I think both of you said that McCain would be the best candidate the Republicans could pick at this time, since the Republicans had everything against them, including a perception of a very unpopular president. So, Tom, you want to start?
I do. I mean, I do believe John McCain was the strongest of the candidates in the field of Republicans who sought the nomination. But in the end, I came to believe, and this is very hard for me because I know McCain and have worked with him for years and just had such enormous regard for him. But I, in the end, decided, in viewing him during the course of the campaign, that however marvelous a public servant he was in so many ways, including a member of the Senate, he was not a particularly good choice for the office of the presidency of the United States. I saw a lack of discipline and organization. I saw an impulsiveness. I saw a kind of swagger that I can do it. I know where Osama bin Laden is. I can get him. And too much sort of I and not us and what it takes to sort of put together an effective government. So that while I think McCain has so many sterling qualities that in the end it was always going to be a long shot given the conditions in the country, but in the course of the campaign, we actually came to learn something about the quality. And set aside your own ideological views, people differ about the efficacy of their various policies, but we saw something of the style of these two individuals. Their minds, their temperaments, their coolness, their emotional qualities, and in the end, that it made it, I think, sort of easier in some respects for the country. That's why I've been speaking so confidently about an Obama victory, because I think you combine the broad structural features of this election all working against the Republicans, the choice of candidates after the campaign is largely over, and then add to that the relative resources available to the candidates, Obama towering over McCain, reflecting the sentiments in the country. The energy and interest in this election is much more on the side of the Democrats, the out party, and that's reflected in his success. You put those three together, and what Americans get is, A, Democratic accountability. They didn't like what had happened under this regime. It's time to try the other one. Plus, I think they have a candidate who would become president, will become president, and who might better fit the particular times in which we live, the zeitgeist, the challenges. It gives an opportunity for optimism, and I've heard this from a number of Republicans as well as independents and Democrats. It's saying, you know, we really need a fresh start, and this man has enormous promise, lots we don't know about him, but you know something, we may luck out. He may help us get beyond these very, very difficult times and make us whole again.
Norm?
Well, I wish that we could do a little experiment and go back to the Sunday before the Democratic Convention when John McCain had picked Joe Lieberman as his running mate, until a delegation from his staff, the ones who drew the short straws, went in to tell him that if he did choose Lieberman, 17 delegations would walk out of the convention, there'd be a meltdown in Minnesota, and he wouldn't get back his base. If McCain had run by saying, you know, it's not a matter of the base, it's a matter of the country, and I'm going to run as the guy whose whole career has been built around building these coalitions in the center, instead of basically adopting a set of economic policies that really were designed to try and appease a base that didn't trust him very much, and making that decision, which took him 3 or 4 days to make, although he made it just like that and impulsively when he chose Palin. First he went through Romney and decided he couldn't stand the guy, and then Pawlenty. But if he had done something like that, there would have been a sizable core of conservatives who would have gone ballistic. But I think it would have gotten people to take a second look at John McCain and view him as potentially a post-partisan president as opposed to a post-racial president. And it might have created a different dynamic. It still would have been very difficult. And as Tom said, we've learned some things about McCain. Those of us who have worked closely with him have seen some of the personal characteristics that have been a little troublesome, but we've also seen a remarkable guy, a genuine hero. You know, somebody asked me 3 years ago after we'd worked together on a reform project, what would you say about McCain? And I said, you know, it really is the case, banal as it may be. If I were in a foxhole and I had to turn my life over to one person, I'd pick this guy. He's extraordinary. But the shoot from the hip style, the emotional reaction to events, the feeling of contempt for Obama and sort of rage that this pissant is beating me, that are unattractive in a president, have emerged. And I think have turned this into a race that he was going to lose by a couple of points, probably under the best of circumstances, into one where it's likely he'll lose more widely. But I'm not saying that a Mitt Romney or a Mike Huckabee or a Rudy Giuliani would be in a better position to win right now. It might have been a narrower margin because they might have run more disciplined campaigns.
Let's thank Norm Ornstein and Tom Mann for a wonderful... I think we have a reception outside for those of you that would like to ask them some more questions. Thank you.